in beta lung, which is pretty intimidating, wondering how it works. The female's a little bit difficult, apart from not having glasses, that's kind of known about females. Estimating their maturity is quite difficult because it's all to do with whether they're pregnant or not, so far onto that date. As well as IDing the sharks and figuring out if they're male or female, what we also wanted to do was see if we can get a good estimate of how big they were. Even though I'd say we're pretty good at eyeballing it and guesstimating, we kind of needed something a little bit more scientific. So what we've worked out is how to use laser photogrammetry. Lasers and sharks in the same job. Yes, you might be right. What we have is a convenient setup where we have the underwater camera, which we use to take the ID photos. And then on each side, we can see in the foreground that photo. That's an underwater green laser. And on the other side, there's a matching one. We set them completely parallel, which is a pain in the bum, I can tell you. And we take them underwater. And what this effectively does is when we take a photograph, it projects these two little spots on the side of the whale shark. And we know exactly how far apart those are supposed to be because we've set it. In this case, it's mostly about 50 centimeters. So we basically projecting a scale bar straight onto the side of the whale shark. So we can use some fancy maths and some body proportions to work out the total length of the whale shark to within, you know, a few centimeters of accuracy, which is a lot better than guesstimation, I can tell you. So for most of this information, we collated it all together, and what the takeaway message from the whale sharks in Tohoku was that most of our sharks, about 75-80% of them, were males, and pretty much all of them were juvenile males as well, so really heavily biased population. And now we sort of knew a little bit more about the aggregation that we had there. We really wanted to also compare it to the other whale sharks around the world. And there's this amazing platform that quite a lot of whale shark researchers use around the world called Wildbook, so whaleshark.org. And not only us, but the researchers across the globe use the same platform, which is great. Everybody uploads their photos of whale sharks and the IDs of their whale sharks. And so you can start to compare your sharks to the sharks of Earth in other places. And it turns out that we are a pretty typical aggregation. Turns out that quite a lot of the coastal aggregations around the world also have mainly small sharks. I say this in context, like less than 8 meters is small. It doesn't feel like a lot of time, but they're small sharks. And also, most of their sharks are males as well. So it seems like quite a lot of the coastal aggregations are pretty heavily skewed towards these juvenile males. So the next question on a lot of people's minds was, all right, that's great, but where are all the big sharks? We know that they can grow up to 20 meters, so where are they? And one of the places which potentially holds some answers is actually in the Galapagos. The sharks that they get there, on average, are between 10 and 15 meters. They're a lot bigger than the ones we're seeing at the coast. Also, they're pretty much all females. So this was a really some good indication that we might get some answers about the adult whale sharks. So Galapagos was unfortunately going to be a focus for us for our research in future. This is our trusty steed, the Mabel. It takes 35 hours to get from some of the islands in the south of the Galapagos. I have such fond memories of emptying my dinner off the back of that boat. Great times. After 35 hours, it's totally worth it. You end up getting to Darwin Arch, which is one of the most remote places in the world, and it is stunning. When we got there, started doing some diving, came across the sharks. They were just as huge as we'd been told. And not only that, most of them were pregnant. So this is really interesting. We know almost nothing about whale shark reproduction and birth. The only information really we have is from a single female that was examined in Taiwan in 1995. She had over 300 teeny tiny baby whale sharks inside her, between about 55 and 60 centimeters. So this is their birth size, we think. These were ready to go. So these tiny whale sharks, we know, we don't really see the little ones either very much. Very infrequently, we get to see the juvenile whale sharks. So that really meant that we needed to find out more about where these big females are going. So we started a tagging program, put some satellite tags on these giant females to try and figure out where they were going and what they were doing, and see if we could find out a little bit more about maybe what was happening with their reproduction. So it turned out that generally these females were spending a huge amount of time offshore. They didn't really come near the coast very much, which kind of made sense because we don't really see them there very much. It also kind of means that they're probably dropping their pups quite a long way from shore, which also makes sense because we don't see the young ones very much either. And you can kind of see why. They are really adorable, but they're just also a little bit pathetic. So these things are like perfectly snack-sized for quite a lot of predators in shore. They've been found in the stomachs of blue sharks and blue marlin as well, so we know that there's probably quite a low survival rate for the little pups. So it makes sense that they're, you know, dropped a little bit further offshore, fewer things to eat them. So for the adults though, they are very, very large fish. And really, once they're adults, there's not very much that can eat them. Apart from being really, really big, whale sharks have incredibly thick skin. Some of the thickest skin in the animal kingdom. They have thicker skin than elephants and rhinos, for example. They're very, very well defended then, once they get to this sort of adult size, above about 4 or 5 meters. And this is just a sort of demonstration of how that works. This is about an 8-meter shark, and you can see on its face, it's got some nice teeth marks there. Those are really big bite marks. They're probably from a white shark or maybe a bull shark. So a really large predatory shark, and really all that happens is got a few scratches left on its face, which is quite intense. There's not many other animals that can survive a white shark attack. So really, adult whale sharks don't really have that many natural predators. Unfortunately, it's not really natural predation that's the problem. Once they get to their adult size, that's exactly the size when people start catching them. So it's actually sort of anthropogenic or human-made mortality that's the problem. Quite a lot of whale sharks get caught as bycatch from tuna purseine fisheries. In some places as well, boat strike is quite a big problem also. And I'm sure that you've all heard the shark fin trade as well. There have been quite a lot of target fisheries in the Far East since the 1980s. And really, since target fisheries began, we've lost about 50% of the total global population of whale sharks. So, as researchers, what's our job? Like, what do we need to do to start helping out? So really, we want to identify important habitats, areas that they're spending a lot of time, protect them in countries where we're seeing them often, where we can try and remove the human threats that might face them in these areas, and then support sort of sustainable development and conservation initiatives once we work out what we're going to do. So we mostly work in Tofu Beach in Mozambique, in Lango Island in Tanzania, and more recently in Madagascar as well. So I have yet to go to Madagascar, but I'm offering my services free of charge, obviously. So in Madagascar, our interest in conservation here, or in general, is to use science to create effective conservation strategies. So in Madagascar, we really wanted to find out what their critical habitats were in the north of Madagascar. We wanted to protect them effectively, and so we need to know where they're going and where they're spending their time. So we started a satellite tagging program. So the you can see the tags floating up the back there behind the shark. It's got quite a long tether on it, this tag, and it's actually quite buoyant. So the idea is that once the shark swims near the surface, the tag floats up to the top. It's got a little antenna that tells us, sends that information out, and can tell us where the sharks are in almost real time, kind of. And what we found out was that, you know, the sharks do swim around quite a lot, but really they're focusing most of their attention on some key areas near Nosy Bay. And that means that's great for us, because it means that if we can manage this area properly, if we can manage gill nets, for example, in these areas, we can have a disproportionately large effect on the population here. And this is a great example of how our scientific work can make conservation initiative a lot better and a lot more targeted. In Mozambique as well, we've also done a lot of this kind of work already over the last 10 years or so. But once you've got this kind of great habitat information and you've identified where the conservation work really needs to happen, conservation then is really mostly about people. So in Tofu, for example, we're helping to support a sort of locally managed and marine protected area along the coast where the wild sharks hang out. We sort of targeted priority areas to remove gill nets and also work on alternative livelihoods. Often in these kind of areas, it's really the fishermen that suffer the most. It's mostly the commercial fisheries that are doing a lot of damage in these places. So, as well as working towards whale shark conservation, we really also need to come up with practical solutions to the physical issues facing local people, which is often a protein shortage because of reduced catch. As well as this, you know, as well as working with adults, we also work with the kids as well. About 60% of the population in Mozambique lives on the coast, but most people don't know how to swim. There's quite a lot of drowning in the area, and a lot of people are very scared of water. So teaching marine education along with swimming initiatives is a big part of the work that we do there. Also, we're training up ocean guardians, so like the taller guy there in the picture. These guys, once they've come through the program, often they don't want to become swimming teachers themselves, and some of them also being employed in the local dive industry. Whale sharks can also be an amazing force for genuine ecotourism development as well. Like I said, we also work in Mafia Island in Tanzania, so we've been able to work with a lot of communities there from the ground up. These conservation initiatives, sorry, ecotourism development, does take a lot of training and management as well of the local tourism groups also. So, unfortunately, whale sharks have really never been in a worse state than they are now. Like I said, we've lost about 50% of the global population already. But having said that, they were in a bad state already, and really, we just know about it now. And luckily for us, most of the problems that they face are, you know, they're genuinely solvable. We can find key areas and protect those areas for the whale sharks. We can, you know, find the areas where they've been caught and do our best to stop the fishing happening in those areas. So they're not massively complicated issues. We can actually solve these problems. And it's really helpful that they're really pretty and that there's a lot of tourism that's developed around these whale sharks. A lot of countries, because of the economically valuable, have gone forward to protect these animals in their countries because of tourism. And we've actually been working pretty hard over the last few years, and MMF has been quite a big part of getting these beautiful animals listed on CMS, so the Convention on Migratory Species, of which all Mozambique, Tanzania and Madagascar are all signatories, so it means that they are now obliged to protect these animals in their countries in some forms, which is great. So we're working with them to try and accomplish that in the best way possible. We know that conservation initiatives can work as well. We're just kind of getting in some initial data from Western Australia, where bell sharks have been protected for quite some time. And they're actually one of the few places now which might be seeing an actual increase in sightings. So we know that if we tackle these problems, that whale sharks will actually recover from proper conservation initiatives. So what can you do? I guess unless you want to become a whale shark scientist, making sustainable choices is probably a good start, especially when it comes to tuna. If you make sure that you're choosing sustainable sources of your fish, I think Greenpeace UK has done an excellent survey of UK supermarkets, so you should definitely check it out. I think M&S is probably one of the best ones. And if you want to support us further as well, we do host research experience as well in some of the best places in the world to see whale sharks, and I'll talk sort of about that in a minute as well. But really, I don't want you to leave being a bit depressed. There's loads of mysteries about whale sharks that we don't know about. It's still really exciting to be. It's still really exciting to be a whale shark researcher. There's so much we don't know. A great example is this is a completely albino whale shark that was seen in the Galapagos a few years ago. This is the first and only time she's ever been seen, and she was pregnant at the time as well. So not only did she survive being almost a glow-in-the-dark whale shark, she's pregnant as well. So if she made it, then you know, it really gives us hope for the rest of the species as well. So these are some of the tricks we run. So like I said, unless you're going to be a whale shark researcher, one of the great ways to support conservation work is to get involved.